I'm Professor Alastair Driver. I'm the Director of Rewilding Britain, and we're here at Broughton Hall Estate, which is one of something like 150 sites I've visited in the last few years for Rewilding Britain to help them get started on the rewilding journey. And this is one of the most transformational because it involves the planting of a quarter of a million trees in a couple of planting seasons, which make it one of the biggest tree planting projects in the country, if not the largest in terms of nature restoration tree planting. So you will have heard me talk in the previous edition we did on rewilding about the importance of natural regeneration and the fact that that should be the default option. But there are plenty of parts of the country, particularly in northern regions, where it would take a very, very long time, many decades, for trees to come back in the landscape because there are so few trees there and it's a much harsher environment. So that's why at Broughton generally we've gone for tree planting as the way forward. But we did have one or two opportunities, like this field that we're in now, for natural regeneration. And that's because it was an arable field ploughed for crops, fodder crops. So this field we've allowed to just naturally regenerate. And initially there's lots of arable plants appearing. Gradually now we're starting to see more grasses coming in. But we are also seeing quite a few young ash seedlings coming from the trees around the edge of the field. Also sycamore and hawthorn, some willow. We won't get the full mix of species we want, so there may be supplementary planting at a later date. But it's a really interesting experiment to compare the health and density and growth rates of the trees that are appearing naturally here compared with those in fields alongside where we've planted. So yes, it's adding more complexity to this mosaic of habitats across the estate. One of the biggest challenges we face with planting projects like this is the use of plastic in terms of tree protection. We have to use tree guards. They need to be 1.2 metre at least because we've got roe deer, we've got hares, rabbits and voles. So we have to use something. And at the moment, there is no mass-produced product that can tolerate these kind of weather conditions in, you know, particularly in harsh upland sites, lasting for 5 to 7 years. We just don't have that solution yet. There are glimmers of hope, and there is a particular guard which is mixing cashew oil and sheep's wool, which looks quite like plastic. And may be part of the answer in certain circumstances, but they're not producing it at scale. So we have to use plastic. And what we say is that, A, we could reuse these plastic guards if we cut them carefully down where the tie is here at the back. You could cut them and retie them, so they can be reused. If you don't reuse them, then the plastic is recyclable. But it's not an ideal situation, and I do hope it won't be very long before we see degradable non-plastic guards being able to be used at this scale. So one thing I should say on the positive side is that some of the grant schemes that are now available are massively useful, and here at Broughton Hall they've accessed what is in effect Nature for Climate Fund money, which was some of which was divvied up to community forest organisations, and it's the White Rose Forest here that have used some of that funding to pay for the tree planting here. And that has proved to be an easier scheme to navigate than, I'm told by the experts, than for example Woodland Creation offers, which maybe come through Forestry Commission, etc. So there are examples where it is relatively streamlined, which is great news. It's a really neat story for me, this use of Nature for Climate money, because I had the privilege to be involved on behalf of Rewilding Britain in campaigning to get people to sign up to calls for government to massively increase the funding for nature recovery at scale. That was about 3 years ago. And that then led to a parliamentary debate because we secured over 100,000 signatures in the space of less than a couple of months. So that then secured a parliamentary debate, and I had the pleasure of briefing ministers and sitting in on the debate. And that debate, I'm told by government officials, led directly to the creation of the Nature for Climate Fund. And now here I am, I act as a private advisor here at Broughton Hall Estate in my spare time, and here I am able to see the fruits of that funding actually delivering on a massive scale on the ground. So really neat little story for me personally.